Do you want to build an awesome cloud computing career? Do you want to learn how the cloud works and have some true deep knowledge and become a cloud architect guru? Well, if so, this video is for you. Hi, my name is Michael Gibbs, and I've been working in technology for over 25 years. In fact, I've been building the cloud long before we ever called it the cloud, back when we called it the network and the data center. And today's video, we're going to teach you how the cloud works. See, the cloud is built upon a few technologies. It's built based on compute, it's built based on networking, and it's built based on storage. And the computing platform can be further divided into virtual machines and containers. And in this series, we're going to teach you how all of these functions work, including at one point, we'll have everybody learn how to build your own cloud from scratch. But in today, we're going to focus on virtualization. So what is virtualization? Besides being the enabling factor of all cloud computing technology, virtualization is critical in any data center, and it's critical knowledge for the cloud architect. So what is server virtualization? Server virtualization is when you take a physical server and then you logically divide up that physical server into multiple logical servers. And by doing this, you can buy an extremely powerful server and it can actually take the function of 10, 20, 30 servers, sometimes more based upon your environment. And by doing that, you can save on power, you can save on cooling, you can save on rack space, but most importantly, you can save on costs. So how is that so useful in the cloud computing environment? Well, the cloud computing environment is stacks of servers, and they're all running hypervisors, which is the enabling technology of cloud computing, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And then when you create an EC2 instance, for example, in the AWS cloud, they're just creating a virtual machine. So in this video, what we're going to do is we are going to take a bare metal server, one that all of you can get, and I'll drop a picture of what this looks like. This particular server has 24 cores, it's got 128 gigs of RAM, it's refurbished, and it is the perfect lab environment for your home if you want to experiment. You can build, take one or two of these, and you can even build your own cloud. But today, we're going to set up server virtualization. So, we are going to install a hypervisor. What is a hypervisor? Well, a hypervisor is a very thin layer of software, and you can see it in this graphic over here, but the very thin layer of software really does this. It takes the host and it manages the host memory, CPU, and disk resources, and it allocates it to the virtual machines that you create. So a hypervisor basically takes a physical computer as a logical layer and then enables you to install your virtual machines. This is the way all server virtualization works. This is called a type 1 hypervisor. And in a type 1 hypervisor, and in this case we're going to use VMware ESXi, what happens is you have basically the hardware, the hypervisor, and then your virtual machines. Now there is another concept called a type 2 hypervisor. This will not be used in the cloud computing environment, but you may have experimented with in the past. This is when you take your computer and you install your primary operating system, whether it's Linux, Windows, or macOS, and then you install something like VMware or Parallels, and then you create virtual machines. Why is that different? Well, a type 2 hypervisor gets installed on top of an operating system, where a type 1 hypervisor basically doesn't have an operating system. The operating system is kind of buried in the hypervisor. It's a little light operating system. So by having an operating system and a virtual machine within an operating system, you actually have a lot of overhead, but not with a type 1 hypervisor. So without further ado, we are going to set up our cloud computing environment now. So to set up our virtualized server, what we did is we downloaded the VMware ESXi option from the VMware website. Now that's going to be in an ISO format. And from the ISO, you're going to have to create a bootable USB drive or CD drive based upon what's on your system. Then you're going to have to tell your computer to boot off of that drive. So here what I've done is I've entered the BIOS on my computer, my new server, and I've put in my drive and I've selected the drive that has the hypervisor installer on it, in which case that's my Samsung flash drive. So what we're going to do now is we're going to get this set up. We're going to boot into the hypervisor, then we're going to install the hypervisor. And then after we install the hypervisor, what's going to happen is we're going to set up some virtual machines and let you experience how what goes on both the virtual machines as well being able to look at the machine, and you can see how the resources are being allocated. So we're loading the installer right now. And here it's going to give us a few options. I'm going to show the options to set this up, and then at some point I may speed it up based on how long the server install takes. But I would like you to see how to set this up so you don't get stuck. So we'll give it a moment or so, and what's going to happen is it's going to give us some options, and we'll set up the configuration options, and then you'll be surprised at how quick and how easy this is to set up. Okay, here you go. Now this is where we're going to start configuring some options, and then it's going to set up our hypervisor, and that's it. Now what you'll get after it's installed everything is it will basically give you the option to reboot. I will tell you, you must remove the bootable USB drive that you placed in there, or it's very likely that your computer will try and reinstall VMware ESXi upon reboot. So I'm going to pause this now, and then we're going to let the server reboot. Now let's manage that server. So remember when this server came up, there was an IP address that you could use for management. So what we've done is we've gone to my computer and I've entered the IP address in the browser window that was listed on that server, so we can manage that server. Now it's our first boot, so we're going to have to log in with the root user account. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to username and we're going to enter our information. Now obviously change some names along the way, and we generally don't recommend logging into anything with a root account, but it's our first boot. So now that our system's up, let's see what this is telling us, because we get a lot of good information from this panel about our server. For example, on the right side, we can find out about how many free resources. So we have 55 gigahertz of CPU resources available. What does that mean? It basically took the cores, which are 24 cores times 2.3 megahertz, and that's the total, or 2.3 gigahertz, and that's the total gigahertz. You can see that every resource uses megahertz or gigahertz. And for example, the resources necessary to maintain this web page and manage the server from the hypervisor are 35 megahertz. And not a lot, very lightweight hypervisor. You can see that my system has 125.45 gigs of free memory, and basically about 2 gigs are being used by the hypervisor itself. And then you can see how much data I have left in a storage, which would not be great for a production server, but would be perfect for a lab environment. If we needed more hard drives, we can add them. So let's create a virtual machine. So before you create a virtual machine, you're going to have to install an ISO file for the operating system you want. Now, what you would typically do is you would go to the data store, and you would go to the data store browser, and you would click upload from the files, and you would upload them from your computer. To speed things up, I've uploaded a Windows ISO and an Ubuntu ISO. So you've got a Windows option and a Linux option. So now let's go back to our host, and from the host, let's create a virtual machine. Relatively easy process, but it gives you lots of customization options. So we're going to create a virtual machine. We have to name it. So let's call this Test Windows System. And we'll pick the operating version, Linux, Windows, Mac OS. And then we'll tell it the version number we're going to use, because it will recommend some basic settings typically based upon what you use. But we're going to use Windows 10 64-bit. We're going to keep it a fairly simple install. But we are going to do a little bit. We are going to add some extra CPU cores. And we're also going to make sure that we've got hardware-assisted virtualization, because we want this virtual machine have good access to the hardware. Now we're going to have to tell it where to get the operating system from, so we're going to put a data store ISO file, and in this case we'll use the Windows disk. We'll use the Windows disk, and then we'll click next, and then it'll tell you everything. We could change anything if we needed to, but this will give you the information: 4 gigs of RAM, 4 CPU cores. If we wanted to change it, for example, let's say we want to change the memory, let's do that. For argument's sake, let's change the memory from 4096 to 8092. Click Next. It'll give us another option to check. And let's click Finish. Now, if we go to where it says Virtual Machines, we see we have a virtual machine here. So let's turn it on. So like any Windows, it boots up and says, press any key to continue. I pressed any key. And look what's happening. Our virtual machine is booting up. And wow, that virtual machine looks a whole lot like a Windows computer. And to the computer, it will be, because it's basically going to see logical hardware and it won't know. So we'll click Next, we'll click Install Now, and Windows will be installed just like any other virtual machine. So while Windows is being installed, let's get a little more virtualization experience. Now while we're at it, let's create another virtual machine. So let's create a new virtual machine. Let's call this Ubuntu Test.
select us version, we'll select Linux. It's going to ask us for a version. For a version of Linux that we want to use, we're going to do Ubuntu Linux 64-bit. We're going to click Next. We're going to click Next. Now it's going to give us the option to choose memory. We're going to choose two CPU cores because we don't want to do anything too slow. We're going to add at least 4096 of memory. I like to make sure that the system always has hardware virtualization enabled. We'll go to the host device. We'll go to a data store ISO file. We'll click Ubuntu. Then we'll click Next and Finish. And now let's go back to virtual machines and let's power this virtual machine on at the same time. Okay, it's booting now. And then we can have two installs going on side by side so you get a good feel for it. So on the right side of our screen, we have Windows that's installing. On the left side, we have an Ubuntu install. And it's going to work just like any other system because to the operating system, it doesn't know. There's going to be virtual cards, virtual drivers, and that's how it works. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to let these systems fully install. And then when they're installed, I'll show you how they work. Our operating systems are loaded, they're booted, and they're up and running. So what do we see? On the right side of the screen, we see a Windows system. On the left side of the screen, we see an Ubuntu desktop. Now, typically speaking, you would be using a server operating system for a virtualized server, although you could be setting up a remote desktop via a virtualized server as well. And if we were to pass through, which we might do another video on, like a GPU, or if we were to pass through a network card, we'd effectively be creating single-root I/O virtualization or high-performance networking. So now that we have two virtual machines, what's going on with the server? Well, for one thing, remember this CPU was only using 35 megahertz before? Now we've used 2.8 gigahertz out of our 55 available gigahertz, so we have 52.3 gigahertz left. Now before we had roughly 125 gigs of free memory, and now we have 113 gigs of free memory. Why? Because the systems are up and utilizing the resources. But as you can see here, we've got two systems up on one server, and we've got room for four, five, six more high-performance computers. Now, we could create micro-instances that are one CPU, and we could use all 24 cores. In fact, we could even do something called oversubscribe. We could use 30 cores, for example. Allocate 30 cores, because chances are each virtual machine is not using a full core all at the same time. But that's a topic for advanced virtualization, and we can do that in another video. But in this case, what we wanted to show you was how to set up a virtualized server, which I think we did. We showed you how to install virtual machines on the virtualized server and how tunable they are. So by the end of this video, you should have a good understanding of what virtualization is, because virtualization is the key element that enables the cloud to work. All the computing instances are all virtualized servers, so now you know what that means. Let me tell you about some things that we do for the Cloud Architect community. We have a Cloud Architect Career Development Program, which is a 16-week comprehensive program that can take you from either AWS certified or working on a certification all the way to being cloud hired. We do everything from teaching you cloud computing, teaching you how to interview, teaching you executive presence, improving emotional intelligence, improving empathy, improving your interviewing skills, and everything we can to help you get hired and hopefully for a higher salary than you would without our help. Now, we have lots of free training options for you. For example, we have a free AWS Certified Solution Architect Associate ebook. It's everything you need to pass the AWS Certified Solution Architect Associate exam, and it's completely free. The link is in the description below. I also want to let you know that every Monday, in order to help the cloud computing community, we have a free AWS Certified Solution Architect Associate mentoring session. And here's what happens. We invite people from all over the world to ask us questions. Anything on the AWS Certified Solution Architect Associate exam is fair game. Bring us your questions and we'll work with you real time to answer your questions. If you're stuck in a particular area, we'll do some free training right then and there with you to make sure that you're not stuck anymore. So if you're our students, great. If you're using our free training materials and you want some free mentoring along the way, great. If you're somebody else's students, we don't care. We love to have you. We just want to help the Cloud Architect community. So now you know about our free ebook, you know about our free mentoring webinars, and every Monday we also have a Cloud Architect How to Get Your First Job webinar. During that webinar, we give you tips and tricks to help you find your first job, help you be more successful in the interview, help you know what the hiring manager wants so you can perfect that interview, you can get your resume in order, and you know what to learn prior to an interview so you can get hired.
Thank you so much for watching this video. I look forward to seeing you in another video next Wednesday. Take care and look forward to seeing you soon.